Good morning and welcome to St. James Virtual Sunday School. If this is your first time here, I would like to thank you for joining us this morning. We are so excited that you are here and we hope that you will be blessed.
Good morning, it's Miss Kim, and our story today is how to be a friend. And it's a little boy named William, and if y'all know Miss Reed, Miss Kim, at school, my children call me Miss Reed, but at church, everybody called me Miss Kim. So if I say Miss Reed, Miss Kim, it's the same person. Okay, so today is a story about how I made a friend, and the little boy in the story is the same name as my son. He was with me sharing story time with me last Sunday and Sunday before that, but tonight he's sleeping, so he can't help me record. But today we're going to focus on the word how to be a friend, and so this is our story that we're reading this week. Okay, how to be a friend. It says, "Hello, my name is William. You are probably wondering, which one of these kids am I? None. I'm not here. I'm here in my room, and this is me, happy and alone. Chasing a ball was never my thing. I will tell you what I like to do. I like to stay in my own quiet room and make spooky masks. You see all the masks that's on this wall right there? I like to wake up really early and walk to school when other kids were still at home, having their breakfast. When there was no one around, I imagined the world dancing around me. I was so happy on my own empty sidewalk. After school, I like to go straight to the park, and at that time, the park was very quiet. I was alone there with one of my scary masks on, I became a monster. Ooh, maybe he scared that cat. Boom! I was so happy it was my own empty park. He did scare the cat. Miss Kim figured it out. And that was my happy little world until, let's see what happened. This kid showed up. My goodness, who is he? I didn't know his name. All I knew that his family just moved to our town. I started seeing him around school and everywhere I went. Here was this new kid. Mm-mm-mm. Every morning, there he was on my sidewalk. He was tiny, but all I could see was him. The world stopped dancing around me. He took over my dear empty sidewalk. After school, there he was again in my park, and he was there every day alone, reading a book. I couldn't even play with my mask anymore or anything. I couldn't play around him. That tiny little kid took over my spot. Then one evening, the worst happened. My parents invited his parents over for dinner and welcome them to the neighborhood. Oh my goodness. My dad asked me to take him to my playroom. My room? No chance. Mm-mm. I had a plan. What's this gonna do? When tiny kid walked into my room, I turned off the lights. And boom! I gave him the tiny kid the scare of his tiny life. And I put on my mask and try to scare him. Did he look scared? But tiny kid stood in the dark and started staring at me in a creepy way. He gave me tiny tingles. I guess he was tiny, but he wasn't scared. Then he started laughing loud like a crazy little kid. Funny monster mask, he giggled. So funny. You're not scared, I asked. No, I like monsters, he answered. I read monsters books stories all the time. We spent the evening cutting and gluing on paper hair to our masks. I was very excited. He was very serious. The mask looked way scarier with freaky hair. He was right. Time flew fast and it was time for the tiny kid to leave. Want to go to the park tomorrow after school? He said yes. We met the next day. Boo! He had on his mask. Little boy, tiny kid had his mask on. And then they met the day after that. I think he's found him a friend by opening up, boys and girls. And then the next day after that too. Let's see what else happens. We still go to the park. It's our favorite place, hangout place. When we were tired of goofing around with our masks, we read one of our spooky monster stories. We had a lot in common. And and I forgot to tell you, his name is Oliver. It's not Tiny Kid. I can still call him Tiny. But did I tell you that we're walking to school together every morning? Really early when the other kids are having their breakfast. Sometimes we talk. Sometimes we are in silence. It doesn't matter. We're happy on our own empty sidewalk. The world is dancing around me. And this time I have a friend to share it with. Now tell me, do you have a cool friend? Let's join in into the best friends album. Okay, so that is our story for this week. And what I like about the story was that he enjoyed playing by himself, and it's fun playing by yourself sometimes, but you know, you get lonely sometimes, and sometimes you need a friend. And so the neat thing about it, he was very resistant to having a new friend or anybody bother him. He had his own little system going on. He walked to school by himself. He played with his mask by himself. And he was forced kind of to have the tiny kid come over because they had a dinner party with his parents. And he wasn't very happy, but he found out that the tiny kid was a lot of fun. They had things in common. And so it just goes to show you, boys and girls, when you open up, you never know what you have common with other people. And so you can make friends just by opening up yourself and talking and exploring some things that you may have in common. And so a lot of times, boys and girls, we're more alike than we are different. So open yourself up and become friends with someone new, someone you don't know. And you never know, you might become best of friends and you might have a lot of things in common. So just remember that. And I know you guys are excited today. I'm recording this on Friday. Today is last day of school for you guys. And I know you're excited. So make sure that when you're at home and relaxing or out in the community or doing different things, open yourself and see, can you make a new friend this summer and see some things that y'all can find in common. You have a great week, and any time that you find yourself doing the right thing, remember to kiss your brain and to shine your halo. Hello, good morning. This is Miss Reed's Reading Corner, and today we have a book about Martin Luther King Jr. So let's get into our book and let's hear all about Martin Luther King Jr. and all the things that he's done. Who was Martin Luther King Jr.? Martin came from a home that was very happy. He had a big sister and a little brother. He had a mother, a father, and they all were kind to one another. Martin was filled with love. Martin also liked being at church. He learned to get along with everyone there, and he made lots of friends. Martin was filled with kindness. At home, even at church, Martin was taught to love everyone, but not everyone was taught to love him. One day, Martin's friend said he couldn't play with him anymore because Martin's skin was a different color. Martin was black and his friend was white. In Martin City and in many other places, black people were treated unfairly. It made him sad and sometimes angry. Martin wished that all people would be kind and fair to one another. He studied and he learned and he thought about how to change things. Martin grew up and he became a reverend and an activist and also a leader in his community. When he spoke, his words came from his big, strong heart and it filled people up with love, hope, and kindness. Martin said that everyone should be treated fairly and that we should never hurt one another. And he said we could change the world peacefully. Not everyone wanted things to change, but lots and lots of people agreed with Martin. Martin showed them that they could be brave, strong, peaceful, even when they felt scared or angry. Together they worked to show everyone that things needed to change. One day, Martin gave an important speech about his dream of freedom and justice for all. Many people were there to listen while others watched him on TV. The world still remembers what he said that day. He said, "I have a dream that one day we will stand up for freedom together and all of God's children will be able to join hands and sing, 'Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.'" Every year we celebrate Martin's birthday to remember what he did and how he filled people's heart. And so on this day and on tomorrow, we want you to work for hard for change like Martin and how you can make the world fair and a better place for everyone. And so thank you for listening.
You and me. morning, St. James, and welcome back to another Sunday for Adult Sunday School. We are going to continue our lesson, which is entitled Ball of Confusion. Our lesson is taken from the ninth Psalm, verses 1 through 12. The ninth Psalm, verses 1 through 12. And today we're going to dig a little deeper into the meaning of the scripture and kind of expand on the meaning of how it applies to us in today's times. So this morning I'm excited as we will continue to explore Ball of Confusion. Our adult unit topic is entitled Called to Praise God, and our adult general lesson title is Praise God for Justice and Righteousness. Amen. Let us pray before we begin this morning. Father, I come to you this morning humble. I come to you, God, with a warm heart, grateful that you've allowed me to see this day. God, I thank you for your strength. I thank you for your power. I thank you for all that you give me and all of us to be able to do your will and to spread your good news that you would have us to do. Help us to be the Christians that you would want us to be and demonstrate by our love the meaning of what you mean in terms of us showing love to others unconditionally. God, as we study your word this morning, allow it to be a lamp unto our feet and a light into our path. Thank you, God, for all your many blessings that you give us each and every day. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Ball of Confusion. The ninth Psalm, verses 1 through 12. On last time, we talked a little bit about our unit of study, our themes of study, which deals with Ball of Confusion. And we read the scripture, verses 1 through 12. And I'm going to share my screen so that you can see. When we're talking about praising God for justice and for righteousness, you know, we kind of need to know what is injustice. And we talked about our affirmation. We value how God listens and responds to our needs, for he will, as long as we follow what he tells us to do according to our guidebook, which is the Bible. Amen. So on last time, I did share with you a few of the injustices that we face, and I want to expand on those a little bit more. The types of injustices that we face in today's times are as follows. Number one, voting rights. You know, exercising the right to vote and encouraging others to do the same. We know that there are groups and or individuals out there that are busy working on legislation, and their main goal is to set up barriers so that we and others cannot participate in this right that we as American citizens should all be afforded the right to do. But it is an injustice when others try to keep us from the rights that we so well deserve. Number two, climate justice. And that is simply being aware and informing the public and also family and friends around you about how we should take care of our global economy. It's critical that we know the ways to save our planet for our children and our children's children and generations to come. So you have people that don't think that our climate is in danger. But knowing that we need to take care of it is detrimental not only to our lives, but to our children. And like I said, generations to come. So being aware and informing others of the right way to take care of our planet. Number three is healthcare. Providing affordable healthcare for all. You know, everyone should be afforded that right to be able to take care of them, of his or herself. And, you know, there are opponents who may not feel the same way, but everyone should be able to receive care. And of course, where we live, we have one of the highest rates that people have to pay for health care. So it is an injustice that maybe if someone is going through poverty, that they may not be able to afford to pay for health care. Number four, the refugee crisis, people being displaced from their countries of origin. And of course, they're trying to find another home due to perhaps, for example, a disaster that may have occurred in their homeland, and they need to seek refuge in our country. And we deny them that opportunity to inhabit our land. So as we've been given the opportunity, let others come as well. Number five is racial injustice. You know, racial justice for all is important. And when we think of racial justice, yeah, we think about the color of our skin not really mattering in terms of your qualifications and your ability to survive and thrive in this world. And when we talk about racial justice for all, think about education, equity for all students, having access to a quality education all over and not it being relegated to a certain area of town wherein you may have your have and have not syndrome. Business, media, day-to-day life, allowing all people from all races to have the right to have access to what others have access to. The income gap is number six, addressing the pay disparities as it relates to one's gender and to one's race. That we don't adjust the pay scale because that person doing the same job as a man for $1 million, the female may get paid $700,000, for example. That the qualification of a person should not be relegated to one's gender and or race. Number seven, gun violence. You know, there are homicides and school shootings, which is just unheard of now, to suicides. How gun violence has just taken a front seat to what we see on our media, on television. And just this past week, just gun violence everywhere. And people, innocent bystanders, whose lives are being taken senselessly. Number eight, food insecurity and hunger. you know, having those areas to feed the masses of people who are hungry and can't afford to get food from a grocery store, from a restaurant. So these are just eight of the injustices that I wanted to expound on for just a little bit. But know this, we are living in a nation that is hurt and divided. And if you take a look at what's going on in the local news or the national news or the international news, we're living in a nation that is hurt and divided. So the question becomes, do we sit back and allow these things as Christians to happen? No, we shouldn't just sit back and ignore the pain and suffering that people are going through and dealing with in these times, because we're all concerned about these and other just injustices that we see in our surroundings, in our homes, in our society, and in the world. So as a people of God, how can we fight the injustices of the world? And I'm going to talk about one of these today, and then we'll cover some others, a couple of others tomorrow or next week. As people of God, we can fight the injustices of the world by praying and repenting. You know, that as believers, you know, we should pray for the wickedness of those around us and for our own sin, because we all fall short. So we pray for those around us who fall short just like we do. Number two, we pray that God's blessing will be upon them. You know, God just didn't create those of us who are following God as best as we know how. He created every last one of us, sinners and all, because we're all sinners. God created and loves us all, and he wants the best for every one of us. And then two, number three says this, we should pray those people who hurt us mentally, emotionally, and physically. Just keep on praying. Pray, pray, pray. And then number four, pray for our enemies. Love our enemies. Love our enemies as we love ourselves. So as a people of God, we can first and foremost fight the injustices of the world if we just pray. Pray to God that blessings will be upon those individuals. Pray for the wickedness around ourselves and for our own sin. Pray for those who hurt us mentally, emotionally, and physically. And pray for our enemies. So this will conclude my lesson for the day. And just remember, in this ball of confusion that we're in the midst of, day in and day out, all these injustices that are going on in the world, the first thing that we can do is pray. Pray. Pray until something happens. Push is the acronym for that. Pray until something moves, until something happens, until there's a shift. But pray and repent. Repent for your sins. Ask God to forgive you. Ask God to forgive them. Pray for everyone. I bid you farewell until we meet next Sunday to continue our lesson on Ball of Confusion. Be blessed and have a great day and a blessed week.
Sunday school is over for another day. Hear us, Heavenly Father, as to thee we pray. Through the weekly with us, in our work and play, make us kind and loving, help us to obey.
Thank you. Good morning, my brothers and sisters, and welcome. Welcome to St. James AME Zion Church. We are excited that you are joining in with us on this morning, and we pray that you have woke up with all grace and favor, feeling good wherever you are tuning in on this morning. At this time, we will have our call to worship that says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. So enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Come on into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Why? Because the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth it endures unto all generations. At this time, let us bow our heads wherever we are for our invocation. All wise and eternal God, we thank you for another opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth. Now, God, no matter where we are gathered at on this morning, I pray that your Holy Spirit would reach us as we are. Father, as we seek to be the church without walls, O God, and go where your spirit is and be the church of the body of Christ and not just in a location, Father, I pray that you will respond and reach us where we are, dear God. Let us feel your Holy Spirit on this morning. It's in your name that we pray. Let us all say amen. Amen. At this time, my brothers and sisters, we will now have our morning hymn sung by the choir.
Thank you.
Amen. We bless God for that amazing hymn on this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. At this time, my brothers and sisters, we will be led in our Apostles' Creed, followed by a scripture lesson and prayer by Sister Winona Newsom.
Good morning. Even though we are at home and wherever you are, this is the time that we reaffirm our faith by the use of the Apostles' Creed, where the Spirit of the Lord is. There is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us reverently and sincerely declare by the use of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. At this time, we will be having our scripture lesson. And our scripture reading is coming from 1 Peter, 2nd chapter. 1 Peter, 2nd chapter. And I begin reading at verse 9. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praise of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
It's prayer time now, saints. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you without even asking you for anything. We thank you, God, for your grace and even your mercy, O God. Lord, we thank you how you're keeping watch over us both day and night. Lord, keeping us safe in our own homes, O God, or wherever we may be. God, I ask that you will be with the workers who are out there on the road, God, working to make sure that the roads will be safe.
Yeah,
God, we thank you, God, for the eternal blessings, O God, that you give to us each and every day. For we realize that it could be another way. But God, you looked down and saw in us, oh God, that we needed you more than we ever needed you before, oh God, and that you blessed us to see another day. God, we ask that you will continue to be with those who are in the hospitals, oh God, as we're facing this pandemic, oh God. God, we ask that you will send healing upon healing to them, oh God. God, we ask that you will be with the people who are incarcerated, oh God. For they do need you also, O God. For God, you created us all, O God. And we count it not robbery, O God, to give your name the praise, the honor, and the glory, O God. God, I ask that you will be with our pastor, O God, as he delivers the word of life, O God, to each and every ear, O God, that it may pierce each and every heart, O God. Let God, even though when it goes into our hearts, God, let it stay there. Let it resonate, O God, so that our faith may grow even stronger, O God. God, we thank you, O God, for our children, O God, who goes back and forth to school just to get their education. God, we ask that you would continue to cover them and watch over them, oh God. Protect them, oh God. God, we ask that you will be with those who are on the front line, oh God, in the schools, in the hospitals, oh God, wherever they may be, oh God. God, thank you, God. We ask that you will even be with our elected officials, oh God. Go into the White House, oh God, and God, touch their hearts, oh God, so they may be directed to
to lead your people in the way that you would want us to be led, oh God. God, we thank you, God, forevermore, Jesus. Lord, we ask that you would continue to walk with us both day and night. In Jesus' mighty and precious name we pray. Amen and amen.
Right now, go.
Amen. Hallelujah. We bless God once again for that awesome prayer and that prayer selection. Now, my brothers and sisters, it's a time in our worship service where we all can participate no matter where we are, and that is through our ministry of tithes and offering, through our giving on this morning. And so we bless God for each and every last person who came on yesterday to give of their tithes and offering. There are also other ways that you can give of your tithes and offering. You can give in person, well, not on this morning, but you can usually give in person. However, if there's someone and you cannot make it out of your house or you cannot go anywhere, if you call up your class leader will be able to receive your tithes and offering and bring them to church. You can also mail in your tithes and offering to St. James and Amazon Church, Post Office Box 335, Goldsboro, North Carolina, 27533. Or you can give electronically through PayPal or Cash App, and all you have to do is follow those names that are on the screen. Our PayPal account is St. James AMEZG Borough, St. James AMEZG Borough. And our Cash App is $ St. James AMEZ Church. That is $ St. James AMEZ Church. Amen. And let us not forget on this morning that this morning on the third Sunday of every month, we make sure that we give our sacrificial offering to our mortgage pledge, that we may pay our mortgage off earlier, that there may be more money to do ministry here at St. James. And so we bless God for each and every last one of you on this morning. Let us bow our heads. Father, we thank you for every gift that is given on this morning, dear Lord. God, we pray that as we offer up our gifts to you, it will be pleasing in your sight. And Lord, that we will continue to be able to do the work of kingdom work here on earth, dear Lord, that we could be able to use the resources that you've given us to bless those in our community for your glory's sake. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Let us all say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It's preaching time, church. And so at this time, I'd ask that you would all turn with me in your Bibles to the book of 1 Peter, the book of 1 Peter, the second chapter. That's 1 Peter, the second chapter. And after we have our sermonic selection, we will have our word. Amen. Amen. We bless God for that powerful song on this morning. Now, my brothers and sisters, turn with me in your Bibles. Turn with me to the book of 1 Peter, the second chapter. That's the book of 1 Peter, the second chapter. And we'll be reading starting at the 9th verse. And just the 9th and 10th verse on this morning. 1 Peter, the second chapter, verses 9 and 10. It says, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own special people, that you may proclaim the praise of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." And so when I looked at this, we were dealing with this text, and what stuck out to me on this morning, it says, "But you are a chosen people." I'm sorry, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who have not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. And this morning, I like to preach from the simple topic, I am a witness. I am a witness. Let us bow our heads and close our eyes. Father, I ask that you will hide me behind your cross on this morning. Illuminate yourself in a mighty way, that we, your people, will be edified and you, Father, will be glorified. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Let us all say amen. Amen. I am a witness. You know, my brothers and sisters, Webster's Dictionary explains the word witness to be a person who sees an event takes place. So who sees an event take place, whether it be a crime or an accident. Another definition is a person giving sworn testimony to a court of law or the police. One acting as evidence or proof, used to refer to confirmation or evidence given by signature, under oath, or otherwise. A witness in the court of law is one who testifies under oath to a particular event, identifying and recollecting either the person, place, or thing in the event or their point of view of the event. And as I prepared for this morning, I learned that there are not only witnesses, but depending on the case, there are specific types of witnesses as well. They are character witnesses who may not have been around for the crime, but one who can speak on behalf of the defendant's character. There are alibi witnesses who will state that a person could not have committed a crime because the person on trial was with them. There are even expert witnesses who look at DNA and observe the angles of cuts within the skin to give us a better understanding of cases. Furthermore, in law, a witness is someone who either voluntarily or under compulsion provides testimonial evidence, either oral or written, of what he or she knows. But church, I'm so glad on this morning that the courtroom is not the only place that we can find a witness. It gives me joy on this morning to know that witnesses are not only at the scene of the crime or at the place of the accident, but as I recall, there are times where witnesses are around the altar and witnesses are right at home waving their hands and witnesses are saying amen to the goodness of God in their life. We are all witnesses that God is still a keeper. As we assess our conditions, we can declare that we are witnesses to God being a heart fixer and a mind regulator. When we see different variants of COVID-19, whether it's Delta or Omicron or Omicron or Decepticons, no matter what it is, we can declare that we are a witness to God making a way out of no way, to God being a provider to his people. Even when we have lost loved ones, we have still witnessed God's power to comfort and heal our broken hearts. We are witnesses to how God can reach down and pull us up out of the muck and miry clay. We are witnesses that there is a God that is working on the inside of us so that we will be changed on the outside. And if all of that fails, we all are witnesses to "I used to." What are you talking about? I used to. We're all witnesses to. You know, I used to lie like a rug, and but then I met a man named Jesus. I used to cuss like a sailor, but then I met a man named Jesus. I used to talk about you like a dog, but then I met a man named Jesus. I used to know that I was going to hell with gasoline drawers on, but then I met a man named Jesus. I'm a witness that I was sinking deep in sin. Far from the peaceful shores, very deeply stained within, steady to rise no more. But the master of the sea, he heard my despairing cry, and from the waters he lifted me. Now safe am I because I am a witness to Jesus Christ. And I like how the definition of witness says that someone who is either voluntarily or under compulsion provides testimony. Because what I know is that once you experience God for yourself, you can open your mouth voluntarily and declare his glory of your own free will, or you can try to keep your mouth closed, but it will come out like fire shut up in your bones. Because when you are a witness, you can only say, I wasn't going to tell anybody, but baby, I couldn't keep it to myself because I am a witness. And this brings us to our text on this morning. We're in the book of 1 Peter in the second chapter. And the apostle Peter gives us some good advice. Peter begins by admonishing us to lay aside all of the things that weigh us down and ensnare us. He said, let go of all malice and all deceit, all hypocrisy and envy and all evil speaking. Then he encourages us that as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the world, that the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have witnessed the Lord's graciousness in your life. He then reminds us that we who were called out by God are chosen and precious to God Almighty. We are living stones building up the spiritual house of God here on earth. The church, as we recognize by today, as we've seen over the past couple of years, the church is not the four walls, but we are the church. We are the brick and mortar of the spiritual house of God, and Jesus is our chief cornerstone. And so Peter says that to those who are disobedient and disbelieving, Jesus is a stumbling block and the rock of offense. Jesus is offensive to anyone who has not experienced his transforming grace. People become offended when you bring up the expectations of God Almighty. People can't handle hearing of God as long, or they can handle hearing about God as long as you deal with the blessings of God. But when you share the expectations of God Almighty, they are offended because his expectations cause them to stumble and then they reject the Lord. But Peter lets us know why they stumble. Peter says they stumble being disobedient to the word to which they have been appointed. Yet there's good news for those who embrace Jesus Christ. He says you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's peculiar people. He says you are a chosen generation. While there are some who willfully are indulging in their own wrath and their destruction, God reminds us that Christians are chosen by God for salvation. We have been chosen to declare to a lost and dying world that Jesus still saves. We have been chosen for such a time as this because you are a chosen generation. But then he says, you are a royal priesthood. Gosh, you are a royal priest. You know, this concept of royal priesthood expresses a level of regality as well as righteousness. You are the child of a king, and so you must walk in the authority of your father, the king, which means there are certain things that are just beneath you as the child of the king. You can't indulge and do certain things because you are a child of the king. Gossip is beneath you, because the king says that life and death lies in the power of the tongue. Mess and chaos is beneath you, because the king says that he is a God of order and not confusion. Fear is beneath you, because the king says that he has not given you a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. Scarcity is beneath you, because the king says that he will supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. Stop living beneath who God has called you to be, because you are righteous royalty. And when you are righteous royalty, you don't deal with lowly things. Not because you're better than anybody else, but your Father in heaven has called you to live to a higher standard. So as we say that we are a royal priesthood, it calls us to a higher standard of living with God Almighty. So we understand we are chosen generation, we're royal priesthood, but also he says you are holy to a holy nation. And so this thing with the holy nation is, the Old Testament teaches us that God called the Israelites, God called Israel his holy nation. That's what we learned in the Old Testament, that through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the 12 sons of Jacob, the people of Israel were created. But as we move along through the Old Testament and into the New Testament, Jesus comes to the scene, and Jesus dies for my sins and your sins and the sins of the holy world and of the whole world. But then Paul reminds us, he says, when God promised Abraham a seed, it wasn't seeds plural, but it was a seed, talking about Jesus Christ the righteous. And through Jesus Christ, we all become a part of that holy nation. And so God has called us to be a part of his holy nation, to declare that we are different. You are citizens to the kingdom of God, and therefore you need to walk as a holy citizen to the kingdom of God. But then he says, not only are we a chosen generation, not only are we a royal priesthood, not only are we this holy nation, he says you are a peculiar people. There's something strange about you. There's something different about you. When you have God on your side, when you are connected to God Almighty, people will see something different about you. You walk just a little bit differently. You talk just a little differently. Your ability to reason, your ability to think and understand and make decisions are different, because they are not guided by the flesh. They're not guided by our human experiences, but they are guided by the Holy Spirit. Our decisions and how we move is swayed by God in our life, because there is something peculiar about God's people. But nevertheless, being a witness has three aspects. And after we have those three aspects, we are going to move on with our day. Amen. Hallelujah. And so the first thing we recognize about being a witness of Jesus Christ is, being a witness, it means declaring your deliverance. Declaring your deliverance. Verse 9 says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. The first thing, declaring your deliverance, you are called out of darkness into his marvelous light. My brothers and sisters, when you know Jesus Christ and you are a witness of Jesus Christ, you must declare that you have been delivered by Jesus Christ. The weirdest thing in the world to me is Christians who don't want to talk about Christ. It's people who are in the faith or who declared that they know Jesus Christ, but then they don't want to talk about what Jesus has done in their life. You ought to be proud of the fact that when you didn't have it together, that it was Jesus who came to your side. It was Jesus who came to your aid. And yet you may have been in darkness, but because of Jesus Christ, the light of the world, you are no longer in darkness, but you are in his marvelous light. We must declare our deliverance, because we all have been delivered from something. We all had to be rescued and saved from some situation, and it wasn't by our own doing, but it was by Jesus Christ. So the first thing about being a witness is, it's declaring your deliverance. The second thing that we see in the text this morning, not only in being a witness, what must we declare our deliverance? It's discovering your distinction. Gosh, discovering your distinction. In verse 10, Peter says, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God. Who once were not a people, but are now the people of God. Discovering your distinction becomes a part of your witness. Because what Peter is saying in this moment is, before God, your identity was lost. Before God, you had no true identity. Yeah, you may have had, have your name, you know, what year you were born, you know, where you work, you know, your accolades, your degrees and accommodations. But Peter is telling us, until you know Jesus Christ for yourself, you can't even understand the purpose that God has called you to walk in life. And so when you accept Jesus Christ, the Lord begins to allow you to discover how distinct and how special you are, how unique you are to the body of Christ, because there is no one like you and there will never be a person like you again, because you are uniquely made by the hands of God Almighty. But you have to discover who God has called you to be. You have to discover what God has called your purpose to be. And it's not walking in somebody else's purpose. It's not doing what somebody else is doing, but God has a plan and a path for each and every last one of us to walk in life. And part of being a witness is discovering your distinction. But lastly, my brothers and sisters, not only must we declare our deliverance, not only must we discover our distinction, but finally, in being a witness for God Almighty, you must dismiss your disbelief. You must dismiss your disbelief. Because in the text, it says, who had not obtained mercy, but now obtained mercy. Any witness should be sure before they take the stand of what they know and or what they saw. If a witness takes a stand and they go up there and lie, they could get caught for perjury. And perjury comes with consequences. But when a witness takes a stand, a witness must believe and understand what it is that they saw. They must have a belief in their foundation about what has happened. And the same is with the kingdom of God. If you declare Jesus Christ and you don't know Jesus Christ in your life, if you talk about the blessings of God and the goodness of God and the grace of God, but you don't have God in your life, you begin to commit perjury. Because you miss the fullness of God Almighty when you don't know Jesus Christ for yourself. And so if we really want to understand what God is doing, we not only must confess it, but we also have to believe it. Because when we believe in what Jesus Christ has done, when we believe in what Jesus Christ is doing, we can declare that we are a witness to God Almighty. We can declare that we are a witness because we believe in his grace and his mercy. We believe that he loved us enough to die for our sins, and we can be witnesses because we remember when he delivered us from the enemy's snare. We believe in what God has called us to be, and Sunday after Sunday and day after day, week after week, month after month, we declare that we believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost and born on the Virgin Mary, who suffered under Pontius Pilate and was crucified, dead, and buried. But the third day, he arose with all power in his hands. He ascended into heaven, and we believe that he sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit. We believe in the Holy Universal Church. We believe in the communion of saints. We believe in the forgiveness of sins. We believe in the resurrection of the body. We believe in life everlasting, because if I believe in Jesus, then I believe that he's coming back again. Do you believe, my brothers and sisters? Are you a witness this morning? Are you a witness that he will pick you up and turn you around and place your feet on solid ground. Are you a witness that he will still make a way out of no way? I don't know about you this morning, but I'm so glad that I am a witness. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. Let us bow our heads wherever you are. No matter where you're gathered and wherever you are, just bow your head and close your eyes on this morning. Father, we thank you for an opportunity, dear Lord, to be your witnesses here on earth. God, we ask that you would watch over us and keep us. Lord, I pray if there's anybody under the sound of my voice who do not know you, that you would keep them until that appointed time. Lord, I ask that you would honor us. Honor our request, oh God. Honor our prayers, dear Lord. And God, teach us to know you better. Teach us to be a more bold and stronger witness for your glory, dear God. Lord, help us to live. And Lord, when we mess up, give us the boldness and the strength to come before your throne of grace to ask for forgiveness. It's in your name that we pray. Let us all say amen. And I'm going to ask everyone who, if you prayed with us on this morning and you need prayer, you need personal prayer, we're going to ask that you would leave a message in our inbox, that you would leave a comment under our YouTube page, that we may pray for you and we may pray with you. Hallelujah and amen. At this time, we're going to have our notices and announcements.
On a journey with St. James and his Iron Church family as we enter the new year by venturing through the good news of the New Testament. We hope that you can invest in this moment with us as a church family and that you will feel so spiritually full that you will never want to live on empty again. Visit our Welcome Corner and you will find a plan that intersperses the four Gospels of the Epistles and other books of the New Testament. Come, let's venture together.
Class leaders, there will be a class leader meeting Tuesday, January 18th, 6 p.m. at the church. Members of the Dynamic Praise Team will rehearse this Thursday at 5 p.m. The Angelic Voices of Zion would have choir rehearsal this Thursday at 6 p.m.
Celebration of Life, Sunday, January 23rd, 2022, 11 a.m. Please turn in names of your loved ones who transitioned during the COVID season that you would like to be honored to Sandra Butler, your church secretary. Attention young adults, ages 22 to 40 years young. The pastor wants to have lunch with you on Sunday, January 23rd, 2022 at 1 p.m. Join him at Barista's Latin Cuisine, located at 103 North Center Street, right here in Goldsboro, North Carolina. Lunch with the pastor, Sunday, January 23rd, 2022 at 1 p.m. All young adults, ages 22 to 40 years young, enjoy.
Human Relations Sunday has been postponed until January 30th, 2022, 11 a.m. service at St. Paul. There will be no 8 a.m. service.
Join us on Sundays for our 8 a.m. live worship service, 2nd through 5th Sundays. Come worship with us here at St. James. Join us on YouTube and in person, 2nd through 5th Sundays at 11 a.m.
Please find time in your week to offer up your thoughts and prayers for our sick and shut in and those who are mourning. Pray over them in Jesus' name. Pray for our pastor, his family, our church. Pray for us, the family of St. James. Pray for unity, love, and teamwork. Pray for the lost. Pray for people everywhere. Pray for peace, grace, and mercy. Be blessed.
Your birthday always comes as we start another year. January is your month. Your special day is here. It's the middle of the winter. Most days are cold and dreary. So here's a birthday wish for you, that your day is bright and cheery. Happy birthday to all who are celebrating a birthday in the month of January.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. If you need more information on anything we discussed during these announcements, then please visit our Facebook page. We hope you have a blessed week, and we will see you the next time.
We pray God's matchless and wonderful blessings over your life. At this time, my brothers and sisters, we will prepare for our benediction. And so let us look to the Lord. And now unto him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ever ask or imagine, according to the power that works within us. To the all-wise God be all honor, all power, and glory, both now and forevermore. Let us all say amen, amen, and amen. God bless you, my brothers and sisters, and have a great week on purpose.